Education. It's the shared answer to so many of society's most urgent questions. How do we expand the horizons of our children? Multiply their dreams? Enlarge the scope of their opportunities in a way that builds a brighter future? How do we help them meet the broad range of global challenges they'll face in the decades ahead? Equip them with 21st century skills needed to succeed in today's competitive digital economy. Education is the answer to so many questions, but providing it raises so many others. Like, how do we best harness the power of technology to improve the reach and effectiveness of education efforts worldwide? How do we orchestrate the professional development of tens of millions of educators around the planet? How can students, teachers, governments, and industry all work together to develop truly sustainable change in our global education models? How can we create vibrant, productive learning environments that will enrich the lives of every student on Earth? We know education is the answer, which means there's really only one question that matters. How do we make it happen?
So, how do we make it happen? So, excellencies, distinguished panelists, ladies and gentlemen, so welcome to the Education Transformation Track. Today we are here for the financing e-learning programs. So I'm Carlos Martinez. I'm Global Director of Intel World Ahead Program. My role is working with Minister of ICTs, with regulatory bodies, with telecommunication companies, with private companies, with ecosystem to accelerate the adoption of ICT in developing economies and also in education. So during today's education track, so we have been listening from this morning at 9 a.m. from ministers, from regulatory officials, from private companies also, from civil society representatives, the importance of embracing change and embracing change in education. And at the same time, what are the key barriers in order to make that happen. So one of the key barriers that had been mentioned several times this morning is, okay, all of us get it, but who is going to finance those programs? And who are the ones that are going to finance the programs in a sustainable way? Okay, so during this panel, this afternoon, we will try to go to answer and to provide some key examples from the panelists here today about how they have tackled those programs in order to finance their projects in their countries in a very successful and innovative way. So to debate about this topic, I'm honored to introduce you His Excellency Mohamed Saril Tarmizi, Chairman of the Communication and Multimedia Communications in Commission in Malaysia.
Thank you.
His Excellency, Mr. Aboubakri Nian, is Director General of High Education at Minister of Education in Senegal. Mr. Eric Lobb is Vice President, International External Affairs from AT&T. And His Excellency Bruno Kony is Minister of ICT and Communications in Cote d'Ivoire. So with this introduction, so we will go with listening from our panelists about their experiences. And after that, I will open to the floor for questions that could come from topics that have been raised from the panelists or other topics that you would like to bring to this panel to have some answer or some insights. Okay, so once lay out that, let me that was unreal. So I know that the Communication and Multimedia Commission has been very active leading actions to reduce the digital divide in Malaysia and to increase significantly the broadband penetration and ICT literacy. ICT literacy has been one of the key problems also raised this morning, digital literacy. So let me ask the question. I know that you have been the leader behind a program providing 1.5 million computers and internet connectivity to low-income families in Malaysia. So let me ask if you can share your thoughts about this program, how you overcome the difficulties. I know were multiple of them. So can you share your insights with our audience, please?
Thank you. Thank you, Carlos. Assalamu alaikum. Good afternoon, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Sharil. I'm from Malaysia. I happen to head the regulatory body in Malaysia. We cover telecoms, broadcasting, postal, courier services. So any communications from snail mail to email, we look at that. We're also an industry development agency. A lot of people don't realize that. And I think what Carlos was alluding to was something that I'd like to just share briefly with all of you. We have a philosophy in Malaysia when we talk about providing access to broadband, access to ICT, access to communications. Underlying that idea of access is to ensure that the access is meaningful. The access is not only meaningful, but fit for the purpose that it's put out there for. Because very often what happens, if you look at access from an engineering standpoint, it's all about just digging up the roads, laying down the fiber, putting up the base station, and there you have it, communications. However, that may not necessarily be meaningful to the people who've never had those facilities. So we started looking at it from the end point, where one of the things that we realized, being a relatively young country with a relatively young population, was we needed to get our youths and our children quickly connected online so that they can enjoy the benefits that ICT brings with it without having to worry whether they are in the cities or in the rural areas. And we have taken the concept of education in that sense from a formal and informal standpoint, in the sense that we, for example, how we did it was we used the Universal Service Fund that we take from the telecoms companies and put that back into the industry by building cellular base stations, Wi-Fi, 4G access infrastructure, and then we realized it's great that we're providing all this access, but how are people going to access it? So we believe very much that the young people in the country will be the catalyst for change. You've heard people refer to the term digital natives. These children and young people are very quick to adapt to technology. Many of us who are slightly, perhaps more advanced in years, find that challenging. And we've had a lot of help from the private sector, from multiple stakeholders, which I call our partners in the industry. For example, we worked with Intel on the Intel Easy Steps program, where basic skills, some of those you may assume or take for granted, how to work with a mouse, how to type a document on a word processing application, how to use a PowerPoint. Those of us who have been using this for a few years may have forgotten what it's like to not know how to do this. So with the Intel Easy Steps program, it was easy for us to do that. And we've had various other support from, you know, our local companies. Our satellite company, Astro, helps provide formal education and learning through satellite television. Our partners like Telecom Malaysia or Telcos provide also free broadband access to some educational content. So there's a lot of that. I can speak more about that later. But the point of it is, the approach that we took was, number one, as governments, as regulators, we may not know best. So the best was to get together a group of experts from the industry, from the community, pool together the resources, and then try and achieve a common objective that we have. And maybe if I have the opportunity, I'll come back to some of the other informal learning that we also did with AT&T, which
absolutely
Eric pointed out.
We will come back to listen from you and from Eric about that experience. Let me ask right now, Eric. AT&T is one of the leading telecommunications in the world, so high-level technology and skills are associated with AT&T. So let me ask maybe a very obvious question. And you are representing here the private sector. So why is important education for AT&T, and what AT&T is doing in education? Can you share that with us, please?
Sure, thank you. Thank you, Carlos. So I'll start with a couple of maybe broad systemic ideas for our industry and our customers, not just AT&T's, but I expect for anyone that's in this business, and then get towards education and the financing question, because I think that it explains why it's such an important topic for AT&T. When you look across the company now and the services that we provide, they require a very high skill to be able to, whether you're working the front line in a store or you're doing an installation or you're doing the design, you're doing the management of services, it's a very high skill sector. And that's the same across our entire sector with the sophistication of technology. So there is an aspect with the importance of education that it's one of the basic platforms of being able to sustain this industry, is to have a well-qualified, highly skilled workforce. And it's something that perhaps in times could have been taken for granted, but then there are a lot of countries, and the U.S. is included in that, where some of the educational systems are failing in places. And so some years back at the executive level of our company, we took a look at the state of secondary education and the dropout rates, and saw that as a long-term risk to us as a company. We have about 260,000 employees. Every year we're hiring over 25,000 individuals. And over the course of time, particularly after we get beyond, in the U.S., the baby boom retirement, we have huge hiring needs. So you match that vector, that trend line, against a trend line of a lot of failing educational systems, and that's a long-term risk. So I start with it in that place, because the plea I suppose I make is that, of course, from the private sector, there is an important aspect of this that's philanthropy, but I'd argue that more important than that, to really motivate private sector involvement and the ICT sector involvement, it's not just philanthropy, it's sustaining your business. It's sustaining the ability over time to be able to hire the individuals you'll need to hire and to create more opportunity there. So we begin there, and I think it's an important perspective. From that, the company decided to make a very big commitment in this area. I mean, that was the driving strategic realization of all the things that we support. Education is a real platform. And a few years ago, we started a program. It's called the Aspire Program, and the initial funding was $100 million, and then last year, we renewed that with another $250 million. And it's importantly, it's not just taking money and just putting it into a failing school system and hoping for the best. It's taking a whole department. We have a lot of different people in our company that try to actually work on going to others in the education field, in the industry. People are thinking about new solutions for education, ways to bring technology in new ways to classrooms, new models of learning, so that we're seeking to bring a technology revolution into education at the same time that we're also propping up the fundamentals of a lot of the schools. So that's just an initial preview of how we're working on this. We're involved in many different aspects of it, but it's an area that will continue to be critical and be involved in for, I would say, a very long time.
Excellent, Eric. So thank you very much for sharing that experience. So from the private sector, why is important education, and how an example of a private company jumping, trying to help addressing the failure of the education system, in this case, in US. So we have been hearing also about the importance from the Minister of Communications of influencing the Minister of Education, changing the way we are teaching and the curricula that we are teaching in order to address the skills that the private companies and the market needs to fill. Okay. So thank you, Eric. So let me ask right now, Honorable Nieng. So college students are the first to get into the marketplace, so once finalized their students. So the importance of having as qualified as possible students to fit the needs that the market has, and the example from AT&T is very real. So I know that in Senegal, your department, your ministry, has been leading a program that has been possible to provide computers and internet in a very affordable way for Senegal. So I would like to ask if you can share details of that program to the audience, Mr. Miani.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Je voudrais vous remercier et remercier les organisateurs de ce forum pour avoir bien voulu nous demander de partager notre expérience.
Thank you very much to his co-chair, and I would like also to thank all the organizers of this forum so that we can share our experience.
Très rapidement, le contexte de cette expérience est né de l'évaluation que nous avons fait du système de l'enseignement supérieur au Sénégal.
This experience started when we actually assessed the higher education in Senegal.
En 2011, le Sénégal, après avoir analysé le contexte de son enseignement supérieur, a défini un plan stratégique sur 5 ans, 2011-2016.
And after we finished this assessment, we started, which was in 2011, we started to define a strategic plan over 5 years from 2011 until 2016.
Dans le cadre de ce plan stratégique, le gouvernement du Sénégal a signé des contrats de performance avec les universités publiques.
And within this strategic plan, the government of Senegal signed agreement, a performance agreement with private companies.
Au niveau du gouvernement, nous avons assigné à chaque université 5 objectifs précis.
And each university had 5 targeted goals.
Parmi ces objectifs, il y a l'amélioration de l'utilisation des TIC.
One of them, the first one, is to improve the use of ICTs.
Parmi ces objectifs, donc, il y a l'amélioration des TIC et nous avons procédé à un financement massif pour les infrastructures dans les universités.
And what we did is we started to a huge financing of the infrastructures in the universities.
Pour quelques exemples, c'est la mise en place des salles serveurs.
Some examples are, for example, some server rooms.
La mise en place de réseaux dans les campus en fibre optique.
Fiber optic networks in the campuses.
Et l'interconnexion entre les différentes universités publiques.
And interconnection between the different public universities.
La mise en place d'un réseau de téléenseignement.
We also set up an e-learning network.
Globalement, c'est un financement d'environ 15 millions de dollars.
This all financing is of $75 million.
Ce financement a été obtenu grâce au concours de la Banque mondiale, ce prêt.
This was thanks to the help of the World Bank through a loan.
Mais également le budget du Sénégal.
But also through the budget of the country of Senegal.
Les objectifs de développement de ces investissements tournent autour de quatre axes.
The aim of the development of these investments are actually around four pillars or axes.
L'amélioration du plateau technologique de l'enseignement supérieur.
Improvement of the technological platform of the higher education.
L'amélioration des applications de gestion.
Improvement of the management softwares.
Le développement des formations à distance.
Development of e-training.
Le renforcement de l'accès aux ressources documentaires.
And strengthening the access to electronic documentation resources.
Après ces investissements qui étaient destinés à rehausser les plateaux technologiques des universités.
Once we invested in order to upgrade the technological platform of universities.
Le gouvernement du Sénégal a pris la décision de moderniser l'environnement d'apprentissage de l'étudiant.
The government of Senegal took the decision to modernize the context of learning of the students.
Et de mieux le préparer au futur.
To better prepare them for future.
Parce qu'après avoir amélioré le plateau technologique.
Once the technological platform was improved.
Après avoir digitalisé le contenu des enseignements.
Once all the contents were digitalized.
Il fallait maintenant permettre aux étudiants d'avoir un outil.
We needed students to have a tool.
Pour permettre donc à ces étudiants d'accéder à l'ensemble de ce plateau.
So that the students may be able to access the whole technological platform.
Donc c'est dans ce contexte qu'est né le programme auquel vous faites allusion, le programme Un étudiant, un ordinateur.
And this is within this framework that the program One Student, One Computer was born.
Alors, le programme est conçu pour permettre aux étudiants d'avoir des ordinateurs à des coûts abordables.
The program is designed so that students can have affordable computers.
Les composantes du programme sont à peu près les suivants en résumé.
The components of the programs are the following quickly said.
C'est d'abord l'acquisition facilitée et contrôlée d'un ordinateur portable pour l'étudiant.
To facilitate the purchase and the controlling that purchase of a laptop for a student.
Une connectivité à l'intérieur et à l'extérieur.
Connectivity inside and outside the campus.
Une exonération des droits et taxes pour permettre au coût d'être acceptable.
Exemptions of taxes so that they are affordable computers.
Et une contribution des universités financièrement.
And subsidies coming from the universities themselves.
Un crédit, un environnement bancaire pour permettre aux étudiants d'avoir un crédit pour financer leur participation.
Students were also able to access to a credit so that they can finance their purchase.
Et toute une série de formations en présentiel pour l'utilisation des TIC.
And then a lot of training so that they know how to use ITCs.
Et une formation en e-learning sur les connaissances de base.
E-learning training for basic knowledge.
Et un service de garantie en termes de support et de service après-vente.
And also a customer service and also to support the
Alors,
purchase.
C'est quoi un peu les fondamentaux du programme?
So what are the program bases or the pillars of the program?
On peut le situer sur deux piliers.
Two pillars.
C'est d'abord un partenariat public-privé et bailleur de fonds.
There's a partnership between the public, the private and the donor.
C'est sur la base de ce partenariat que nous avons monté le financement.
And it is based on this partnership that we set up the financing.
Le premier appui, c'est le financement de la Banque mondiale qui était destiné au contrat de performance des universités.
The first support came from the World Bank, which supported the performance agreement with universities.
Les universités ont pris une partie de cette subvention.
Universities used part of these subsidies.
Pour appuyer les étudiants dans le cadre de l'acquisition des ordinateurs.
To support the students when they were purchasing a computer.
Le deuxième partenaire dans ce schéma,
the second partner,
c'est le gouvernement,
is a government,
pour encadrer et superviser le processus de la convention.
In order to frame and oversee the processes of the process of the agreement.
L'innovation de la position du gouvernement.
What is new is the position of the government.
C'est d'encadrer le processus.
because they are managing the process.
Sans encombrer le processus.
Without being an obstacle to this process.
Le troisième pilier, ce sont les universités.
The third pillars are the universities.
Pour la définition des priorités, quels sont les étudiants qui devraient acquérir les ordinateurs?
In order to define what are priorities and which students should be the one that can purchase these computers.
Et identifier les bénéficiaires.
And also identify who should benefit from them.
Nous avons également Intel.
We also have Intel.
Qui a été un partenaire.
Who has been one of our partners.
Pour l'accompagnement et l'élaboration du projet.
In the support and design of the project.
Parce que le gouvernement du Sénégal avait les ressources.
Because the Senegalese government had the resources.
Les universités avaient identifié les bénéficiaires.
University had identified who would be the target.
Il manquait quelque chose pour mettre tout ça en cohérence.
But we needed, there was something lacking to establish a consistency.
Et mettre en avant le projet.
And start implementing the project.
C'est en cela que nous avons eu l'appui d'Intel.
And this is where Intel came into play.
Nous avons également l'appui d'une banque au Sénégal.
We also have the support from a Senegalese bank.
Parce qu'elle paye la bourse aux étudiants.
Because it pays the student's grant.
Et elle permet également aux étudiants d'avoir un crédit à partir de cette banque pour financer leur participation.
And students can also benefit from a credit to finance.
Nous avons eu un fabricant d'ordinateurs.
We have also a manufacturer of computers.
Qui sans appel d'offres.
Which without any bid.
A voulu positionner ses ordinateurs dans le marché.
Willingly wanted his computers to be part of this project.
Si vous me donnez l'autorisation de dire, c'est Samsung.
If I may, the name of this maker is Samsung.
Je m'excuse si ça a l'air publicitaire, mais c'est juste pour un exemple.
I'm sorry if it sounds like advertising, but it's just to give
Et
an
enfin,
example.
Et enfin, une entreprise nationale.
And finally, a national company.
Qui est chargée de la distribution.
Who is in charge of distributing the computer.
Voilà un peu comment le programme s'est organisé.
This is how the program was organized.
Maintenant, l'avantage de ce programme.
The pros of this program.
C'est le modèle de financement.
Is the financial model.
Et la question est de savoir
and what we need to know
comment financer le programme
is how to finance a program
pour permettre à l'étudiant
so that the students
de donner une faible contribution.
Can also actually chip in.
Alors, la réponse se trouve à quatre niveaux.
And we have found the answer on four levels.
Premier niveau,
the first level,
le gouvernement a exonéré les taxes et douanes.
The first level is that there was exemption of customs taxes.
Le deuxième niveau,
the second level,
c'est la subvention qui a été accordée aux étudiants par les universités.
Is the subsidies that were granted to students by universities.
Cette subvention, c'est à peu près 50% du coût de l'ordinateur.
And this subsidy represents 50% of the cost of the computer.
L'exonération du gouvernement,
the exemption from the government,
c'est à peu près 26% du coût de l'ordinateur.
Represents 26% of the cost of the computer.
Le troisième pilier, c'est le crédit, c'est la participation de l'étudiant lui-même.
The third pillar was the engagement of the student itself.
Et cette participation, c'est à peu près 24%.
And this contribution was of 24%.
Donc, il y a une subvention de 50% de l'université.
So you have 50% coming from the university.
26% de subvention pour les droits et taxes que l'État a exonéré.
26% coming from exemptions of taxes from
si
the state.
Si bien que l'ordinateur revient à peu près à 24% à l'étudiant.
Thereby, the computer costs 24% of its overall cost for the student.
L'autre pilier, c'est la banque. Au Sénégal, la banque commerciale.
Oh, the pillar was a bank, the commercial bank in Senegal.
Alors, cette banque permet de accorder un crédit à l'étudiant.
This bank grants, gives a grant to the student.
Parce que la banque gère la bourse de l'étudiant.
Because the bank is the one which is managing the grant of
Donc,
the student.
Donc, il faut lui faire un crédit sur 10 mois ou 12.
Thereby, he can have a 10 or 12 months credit line.
Aux environs, à peu près, l'étudiant donne 5 000, à peu près 10 euros. 5 700 quelques 10 euros.
So something around 5,000 something euros.
Si l'étudiant n'est pas boursier,
if the student is not someone who is benefiting from a grant,
il peut verser lui-même.
He can himself pay.
L'équivalent de ce que la banque lui aurait prêté.
The equivalent of what the bank would have actually loaned to him.
Pour l'ordinateur d'entrée de gamme, le coût total que l'étudiant devait donner moins de 100 euros.
For the first computer, the standard computer, the lower range of computers, the price would have cost about 100 euro for a student.
Alors, par ce modèle,
so through this model,
La banque partenaire au Sénégal qui s'appelle Ecobank.
The Ecobank, which was the partner bank in Senegal,
a fait un prêt aux étudiants d'environ 170 000 dollars.
Loaned approximately $170,000 to students.
Les universités ont subventionné les étudiants.
Universities subsidized students.
À peu près pour 780 000 dollars.
And this cost universities $780,000.
L'État a subventionné les étudiants.
The subsidies from the state.
Sous forme d'exonération de taxes et douanes.
Through exemptions of taxes and customs.
Pour à peu près 400 000 dollars.
For $400,000.
Nous avons obtenu, il y a 20 000 étudiants qui la première année sont inscrits au programme.
So the outcomes are 20,000 students actually enrolled the program.
Nous avons eu un démarrage tardif.
It was a late start.
Mais à l'arrivée, 6 000 étudiants ont pu avoir leur ordinateur.
But at the end of the day, 6,000 computers were distributed to students.
Si vous me permettez, je partage avec vous les facteurs de succès de ce programme.
So what I would like to do is to share with you the factors that help for the success of this program.
Let me just, if you can go briefly to the results in just 1 minute, because we are running, we still need His Excellency the Minister Bruno Conné, and also from the audience. So if you can just brief, go to your point in just 1 minute, and we will go through another question. And we will have more time to come back to a great example of the student program in Senegal.
Très bien, Monsieur le Président.
Very good. Thank you.
Donc, en résumé, les succès du programme, c'est sur trois choses.
Successes are three.
C'est la volonté individuelle de l'étudiant de prendre ou de ne pas prendre un ordinateur.
The individual will of the students to buy or not to buy a computer.
Deuxième point, c'est l'État qui lui permet en lui exonérant des taxes.
The second point is the state which enable this by tax exemptions.
Et la troisième chose, c'est la possibilité pour lui de recourir à une banque pour financer sa participation.
And the third point is that the student could use a bank to finance this purchase.
Avant la fin, nous reviendrons sur la pérennité du programme.
And
les perspectives du programme.
Later on, we will talk about the sustainability and perspectives of the program.
Je vous remercie.
Thank you very much.
So, thank you very much. So, very good example. So, we have heard about tax exemption. We have heard about credits, loans from international banks and Senegalese banks. We have heard about subsidies from universities. So, very innovative way to get the solution affordable for students in Senegal. So let me right now go to His Excellency, Minister Bruno Conné. So I know you have been leading a key program also in Côte d'Ivoire. You recently announced a program to provide 500,000 500,000 families computers and internet. So I would like you to share with us and with the audience the details of that program and the financing way of that program also. Please.
Je vous remercie, Carlos. Je voudrais commencer par dire que l'illettrisme et l'analphabétisme sont de vrais défis auxquels nos pays sont confrontés. Parce qu'il est évident que des personnes qui ne sont pas allées à l'école, qui ne savent pas lire, qui ne savent pas écrire, sont d'emblée un peu exclues du système de production. Ou même quand ils sont dans le système de production, ils contribuent moins que vous et moi, par exemple. Donc il est important que l'ensemble de la population, d'une façon ou d'une autre, soit formée, ait accès à l'écriture, à la lecture, etc.
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
Thank you, Carlos. First of all, I'd just like to say that illiteracy is a major challenge for our countries. Somebody who has not been to school, somebody who's not who can't read or write, is really excluded from the system of production, or even if they can read and write to a certain extent, they are less productive. So it's very important to ensure that access is provided to the population to training and education.
Pour un pays comme la Côte d'Ivoire, malheureusement, c'est encore 40% d'analphabètes. 40% de personnes qui ne savent ni lire ni écrire. Et dans certains pays africains, vous avez des taux qui atteignent les 80%. Donc vous voyez le fléau que cela peut représenter. Et
In the Côte d'Ivoire and the Ivory Coast, the level of literacy is 40%. 40% of the population can't read or write. Mm. And in other African countries, this figure is as high as 80%. So you can see what a serious problem it is. Mm.
Et heureusement, nous avons les TIC qui sont aujourd'hui une vraie opportunité. Une vraie opportunité pour régler, pour fixer ce problème, pour trouver une solution à cette difficulté. Mais régler le problème de l'illettrisme, ce n'est pas seulement donner des PC, ou ce n'est pas seulement mettre à disposition du contenu didactique. Il s'agit, de mon point de vue en tout cas, de créer un écosystème global dans lequel il y a une cohérence d'ensemble.
ICTs are really an opportunity to address this problem, this difficulty that our societies face. And I think that combating illiteracy is not only a question of providing PCs and educational content, but it's also important to create a whole ecosystem and to ensure consistency right across that ecosystem. Mm.
Parce que celui qui aura le PC, il aura besoin d'un environnement réglementaire qui le sécurise. Il aura besoin de connectivité, parce que, évidemment, s'il n'y a pas de débit, c'est une difficulté. Là, nous parlons essentiellement de l'aspect accessibilité, ce qui est effectivement une contrainte, mais ce n'est pas la seule. Après, il y a le contenu. Une fois qu'on a créé, il faut qu'il y ait également du contenu pour intéresser les étudiants en question. Et puis, nous pensons également que dans cette stratégie globale, à un moment ou un autre, il faut également des ressources humaines pour, à chaque étape, apporter l'aide qu'il faut. Il faut des ressources pour installer les équipements, il faut des ressources pour faire la maintenance, il faut des ressources pour faire la formation, etc., etc. Donc, tout cela nécessite un plan global. Et c'est pour ça qu'en Côte d'Ivoire, nous avons opté pour ce choix. Donc, mettre en place d'abord une stratégie d'ensemble dans laquelle chaque pan est mis en œuvre.
So when you provide the PCs, you also have to ensure a regulatory environment. You have to ensure security, connectivity, the appropriate bit rate, accessibility. But then after you have dealt with all of these issues of putting in place the infrastructure, you have to deal with the content. Mm. So it's very important to have an overall strategy to provide the human resources, to provide the equipment, to ensure maintenance, to ensure the training necessary so that people have the right skills. So this is what we've done in the Côte d'Ivoire. We have established an overall strategic plan to implement this development of our ICT sector.
Mais pour revenir spécifiquement à la question qui a été posée, donc ce projet de 500 000 ordinateurs, c'est un projet qui rentre dans le sous-point accessibilité de notre stratégie.
So to answer your question about the 500,000 computers, this is dealing with the section of our plan under the headline of under the heading of accessibility.
Et dans ce point accessibilité, nous avons deux voies. Une voie qui est l'accessibilité individuelle, c'est dans ce cadre que ce projet se mène, et il y a également l'accessibilité de façon collective à travers des salles multimédia, des centres multimédia, et nous avons le projet de créer jusqu'à 5000 centres multimédia dans des zones rurales. C'est des petits centres avec 10 ordinateurs, 20 ordinateurs, 5 ordinateurs même, selon la taille du village, qui permettent aux populations, quand elles le souhaitent, d'accéder donc aux ressources de l'Internet, par exemple.
So we have two tracks in this strategy to provide accessibility. One to individuals, but also to provide collective access via the creation of multimedia centres in rural areas. We're planning to set up 5,000 of these across the country, and there will be 5, 10, 20 places according to the size of the village, but this will enable people to have access to internet and to these new technologies.
Sinon, en ce qui concerne l'accessibilité individuelle, nous sommes dans un schéma qui est très proche d'ailleurs de celui qu'a décrit M. Niang du Sénégal. Sauf que nous l'étendons à des classes de population qui sont plus larges, puisque le nôtre, c'est un citoyen, un ordinateur. Un citoyen, un ordinateur. Nous avons commencé par les enseignants, un enseignant, un ordinateur. Nous allons faire effectivement un étudiant, un ordinateur. Ensuite, nous allons faire un médecin, un ordinateur, un fonctionnaire, un ordinateur. Donc l'idée, c'est d'étendre le plus possible l'accessibilité au plan individuel sur des bases qui sont très proches de celles qu'a décrites M. Niang, en nous basant essentiellement sur la défiscalisation du matériel, en nous basant sur la subvention qui, dans certains cas, peut être accordée au matériel. Parce que nous estimons que pour un enseignant d'université, par exemple, lui, donner un PC, ben, c'est démultiplier la possibilité de toucher d'autres personnes derrière, notamment les étudiants de cet enseignant. Et donc, il y a un intérêt public qui peut justifier la subvention qui est faite à cet enseignant-là. Et puis, la troisième chose, nous apportons le financement. À travers une banque aussi, avec un appui ou une garantie de l'État. Donc le financement est apporté par la banque. Traduction. Sorry. I'm sorry.
So as regards the first of the two tracks, individual access, we have a strategy that's rather similar to that described by Mr. Niang from Senegal. But we're targeting a broader segment of the population than just university students. The slogan is one citizen, one computer. We started out with teachers, one teacher, one computer, then the idea is to extend it to students, one computer, one doctor, one computer, one official, one computer. And then we also, similarly to Senegal, we have a system of tax exemption and subsidies. For example, for universities, this is a means of spreading the access to this connectivity. Universities can reach out to a larger segment of the population. So there's a public interest that justifies the granting of these subsidies. And then the other aspect to promote the spread of these computers is to provide appropriate financing. The banks can provide the money, and the banks benefit from a guarantee from the state.
Ok, je vais peut-être m'arrêter là et tout à l'heure approfondir si nécessaire.
Continue this at a later stage.
Thank you very much, Excellency.
I was just going to say, as a segue to His Excellency Minister's comments just now, I was talking about the supply side, but there's also the demand side that we have not touched on. For example, I think you may have heard my minister mention this morning that one of the key things that we started out with a long time ago was getting our industry, the telcos, involved in pushing ICT access for education. We started with actually providing broadband access to 10,000 schools in 2003, 10 years ago. I can share with you some of our failures, so maybe you don't repeat them. Some of the learnings. I think it's important to learn from the failure so that from there, we can avoid some of the things. For example, in 2003, all the wisest men in Malaysia thought the broadband required for schools, 1 megabit to the school, should be enough. Because in 2003, there was very little and material that was online, and a lot of the communications between the schools was just purely for communication. How wrong we were. Now, schools, if they have anything less than 10 megabits, at least in Malaysia, they say they don't have enough. And when we introduced the laptops into the schools to help bolster the informal part of the education together with the formal part of education, even 10 megabits now becomes not enough. So if you ask me what is the next number, I honestly do not know. But I would agree with the two other panelists earlier. One of the things that we also did in Malaysia was we removed all taxes on computers, all taxes on ICT devices, including tablets, because we've also learned that laptops and computers will be one form of access to ICT, but increasingly, especially in the last 3 years, tablets or phablets or smartphones have become the norm. And we're seeing, again, another transformation going through about how all these devices are being used in education. I think in the earlier session this morning, when the ministerial forum, there was also that question about teachers being ready or not ready to teach. We have found that to also be quite true. Whereas the children will adapt and adopt technology very quickly as part of their lives, we've had to spend a lot of time and money and effort together with the education ministry to transform the way in which teachers approach this. And as I mentioned, we use multiple technology platforms, be it broadband, satellite, normal terrestrial TV program, to provide a wholesome educational ecosystem. Because for us, it's not just about broadband, as I mentioned. It's about meaningful access to broadband, and education happens to be, to us, a very, very important priority.
Thank you. So just a reminder, so we have had two sessions this morning. This session, and this is why I'm asking this question about financing, is specifically about financing, but it's really good sharing the BKMs and sharing also the failures. Sometimes we learn more from the failures than from the success, so thank you, Sanil. So let me summarize till now. So we have heard the use of universal service funds from Dato Sanil. We have heard also from Eric how the private sector has been really involved and is involved trying to have the skills that are needed to continue running the business. So we have heard from His Excellency Niani a very integrated program in Senegal that goes from setting the laying out the plan and also the content, the universities, and at the end, securing that the students can have access to the technology in a very affordable way. And from His Excellency the Minister, we have heard also a very integral plan on how to address one of the key programs, that is digital literacy, and also involving officials, also involving health, education, so, and also using all the kind of tools that a government has, that is taxes, that is subsidies that make the economy grow and have a sense for the society. So let me open right now the panel to the floor. So I would like to have 2-3 questions. Please be brief in your questions, and then we will come back to the panelists. So anyone has any question for the panelists that would like to raise? Please, can someone provide a microphone for her? Please identify yourself and try to be brief.
Yes, my name is Djerrie Toudjeng. I'm from Orange, which is a telco operator in Senegal. I would like to ask from you, from AT&T, what have you done related to connectivity, and also in Malaysia related to connectivity. What have you done specifically for school? Is it special fares? Is it free for school? What have you done?
Okay. So before to answer any additional question, so there is a direct question for Eric and direct question for Cyril. And okay, so a microphone for him, please.
Thank you. My name is Orlando da Mata from Angola. I would like to know how many students you have in the high school, high level. Thank you.
To who is this?
Senegal.
Okay. So please, Eric.
To answer the question, actually, in quite a number of countries, because we operate, we have licenses in about 60 countries, and I can't remember off the top of my hand how many, but there are quite a number of the countries where we have services where there is a government program in place, to ensure that anchor institutions, libraries, schools, et cetera, have a broadband connection, and it can be through some form of either it's, universal service program or some other form of, e-education program. So that's certainly one way in which we have been involved in that aspect of transforming education. And perhaps later after we come back to things, I'll talk a little bit more about how we are using some of the more advanced connectivity and cloud technologies to change the way of delivering education curricula. Okay. I'll come back to that after Cyril, perhaps.
Thank you. Short answer to your question, actually, it was a combination of things. We started off by using some of the Universal Service Fund to subsidize broadband access to the schools, in some schools. But what we've discovered as we went along our journey, we realized that, and the telcos realized that, this was an opportunity for a new market for them. What happened was when the kids were connected in school and then they started then having to do assignments and research online, they then had the desire to have the broadband. And when the teachers wanted to communicate with the parents, that also created a desire to have the broadband. So the telcos then realized that this was a new market that didn't have to spend so much money doing advertising and promotion. It was a captive market. So what they then did was they introduced special fares, special tariffs for the school kids and the family. They have a family package where for a certain amount of money, a fairly affordable package, the family plus people in the family could have access to the internet on broadband and also access to school. So the creation of the environment led to an economic opportunity for the service provider, and that led to the development of the ecosystem. Because if you think about it today, even here in Thailand, I think if you drive around, you'll see some of the biggest advertisers are telcos. Billboards all over having, so many baht for so many minutes and so on. Same thing in Malaysia. If you look at the advertising promotion budget that a telco spends in a year, they are in the hundreds of millions. Now, instead of spending that money, it's one of the conversations we have, the telco was, instead of spending that kind of money, if you were willing to come in and join us together with the education ministry to see how we can help provide access to schools, then the same amount you spend on advertising and promotion, this one almost guarantees you a subscription, whereas the other one was potentially would just introduce you as a brand, and then you find your competitor comes in and charges a lower price and you lose the potential customer.
Very good example of private and public partnership. And at the end, the benefit is for the society and for the country. So let's go to the second question for His Excellency Nyeni about Senegal. How many high students?
Merci pour la réponse à la question de la ville d'Angola. C'est à peu près 120 000 étudiants dans les 5 universités publiques, à peu près 30 000 étudiants dans une vingtaine d'établissements privés Et cette année, le Sénégal a créé une université virtuelle qui va accueillir 6000 étudiants.
We have about 120,000 students in the five universities that we're targeting, public universities, then 30,000 students in the private, and this year we're going to have a virtual university.
And thank you for the question.
Yes.
Okay. Very good question. So let me, please.
Just would like to thank Dr. Sanil for his observation and his help to learn from the failures and errors. But I think clearly that this error happened because they didn't have the holistic view I'm talking about. You need to have a complete view, a strategy taking into account each aspect of an ICT development. So regulatory environment, infrastructure, or connectivity, accessibility, content, and human resources. If one lacks, you go straight in. In a mistake, in an error.
It's very true.
Just to give.
10 years give later, we learn about it. Yes. Now I can say, yeah.
Okay. Just for the benefit of Dato Sarial, we say it was 2003, so 10 years ago. So
nobody was even thinking of it in 2003. Yeah.
When we were thinking was different.
But this is the result of the BKM sharing, so an improving programs every year. And. Learning from the failure. So, and you have mentioned in several times, Minister, about content. So we have, after this session, a panel specifically on content. We now is really key and local content. So for those of you that will be interested on now more about content and educational content and how we overcome that barrier. So please stay in the room, and in the next panel we will go through that in a big way, okay? So let me ask also again to the panelists one question to share with the audience. So every of you have implemented very innovative programs and found ways to finance those programs in a very innovative and creative way. So I would like to ask, what has been the, for you and for the audience here, in order to learn? Imagine that you are talking with your colleagues and you are making, sharing what is the key difficulty that you find to make happen. Remember how we make happen. So what is the key difficulty that you have overcome to make happen your program, and how you resolve it? So, and I will ask also if you can be brief in your reply, so we have more time for the audience also for, again, have the floor in questions. So please, first, Dato Sanil.
Thank you. Key difficulty, if I can look back at history, is changing the mindset. And bear in mind, when I say changing the mindset, I am talking about an environment 10 years ago, in 2003, when nobody was talking about broadband, everyone was still talking about internet. People thought broadband was in the area and the domain of Google. Even Facebook wasn't really up. Twitter was not even anywhere. So that was the time we were doing some of these things. But the biggest challenge we had then, and even to some extent today, is changing the mindset. People would say, you know, I have $10 to live on today. Why do I need to take $1 to pay for broadband for one day? So the challenge was showing the utility value of broadband and how broadband can help transform their lives, can be meaningful to them, so that they will see the benefit that it brings. That was the biggest challenge. It remains a challenge in some of the further outlying communities. you know, we continue to struggle, which is why here at ITU Telecom World, we decided to showcase some of the transformational powers of broadband to show people that it's not about the broadband. It's about how they can improve their lives with a little assistance from broadband. I think that helped to break through some of that. Responding to the question, why do I need broadband? I've lived 50 years of my life with no need for broadband. Why do I need to have one now?
Thank you. Eric, from you, if you want to share one of the programs that I know ATT has been a step forward trying to help together with universities, the gap that AT&T has identified, so please share with us.
So, you know, a little bit earlier, Sheryl was talking about the need to transform programs, and particularly so to address the affordability and access issues of education. I mean, we talk about affordability and access of connectivity, but, you know, affordability and access of education, particularly at the higher education level, is a really significant issue. And, you know, when you look at all the different sectors where there's been huge productivity gains from technology, education hasn't necessarily been one of them in terms of the business, the model of education, particularly higher education, which is an instructor, students in the classroom, right? That's the traditional model. So the full productivity benefit of technology kind of had lagged in the education area. And so that's another area where we were, again, looking at this issue, this skills gap coming down the line, and seeing if there could be something more effective to reach more people more affordably, more broadly, using the strengths of connectivity, using the strengths of cloud-based technology. And so we recently worked together with Georgia Tech in the US to create a Master's of Computer Science entire course as a MOOC, as a massive online course, an entire, absolutely, this full-blown Master's of Computer Science curricula as a MOOC. And the registration opened up for this it's about 2 months ago that the registration for the next curricula cycle opened up, and some of the feedback came back after just a month and a half of registration. They had multiples more registration than they have over the course of an entire year coming up. And this is only about 2 months. There's already participants from 80 countries registered, all 50 states in the US. The entire Master's of Computer Science degree is I'm forgetting the exact amount, around $7,000. But in the US at least, a fraction of a traditional cost. And, you know, the benefit here, again, is you're going to spread the training of a very much needed high skills area where there's a shortage of supply, and it's trying to just approach the challenge from a different way and trying to bring some of these productivity differences to this field. So that's actually it's a very new development, which we're excited to see how it works out. Great collaboration with the university, and we'll see where it goes. But we're excited for it.
Excellent program, an excellent example. So, His Excellency Nian, so can you share what is the key difficulty that you think you would like to share with the audience, and also if you can share with the audience, what is the monthly fee that a student need to pay for getting the computer and the internet in the student program? I think it will be awesome for the audience. So please, and I try to be concise so we have more time for questions, but please, go ahead.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Alors, pour les difficultés majeures, je peux citer pas une, mais trois.
Regarding the difficulty, I can name one. Not only one, but three, sorry.
La première, c'est de convaincre le gouvernement que c'est un programme sérieux. Il faut renoncer à 26% de taxes et douanes.
the first thing was to convince the government that this is a really good program and that they had to renounce to 26% of 26% of taxes.
Deuxième difficulté, c'est de apprendre à faire travailler ensemble des gens qui n'ont jamais travaillé ensemble, la banque, les étudiants, les distributeurs de machines.
The second difficulty was for people who never worked together, the bank, the students, and the manufacturer of the machines, to work together.
Et la troisième chose, c'est d'avoir un financement à la hauteur de, du programme.
And the third problem was to actually raise the financing up to the level of the program.
Combien coûte précisément la connexion pour l'Internet? Nous sommes aujourd'hui en discussion avec les sociétés de télécommunications au Sénégal.
Well, how much is the connection? Well, at the moment, we are discussing with the telecoms company in Senegal.
Et nous pensons qu'on aura au maximum moins de 2 à 3 euros par mois pour un étudiant pour accéder à l'Internet.
And we think that per month for a student, he will pay between 2 to 3 euros per month to access Internet.
Surtout quand il n'est pas dans le campus.
Especially when he's not in the campus.
Parce que dans le campus, il y a le Wi-Fi sur le campus et dans le campus social.
Because inside the campus, they can benefit from a Wi-Fi everywhere.
Je vous remercie, monsieur.
Okay. So thank you very much. So three key barriers for your colleagues on how to overcome the problems to make it happen, the program. So let's go to His Excellency, Minister. So can you share the key difficulties from your program?
Okay. I'm trying to help you save some translation time, but the consequence is my very poor English. I'm sorry for that. I think the first difficulty we had in Côte d'Ivoire is a paradox, because it is the delays coming from the state itself. We had to go through tenders, for example, to choose the supplier, and only in that point, we've lost 1 year. 1 year. That's why I'm very surprised. In Senegal, we have to just to choose the supplier. Maybe Mr. Nian will tell me how they did. But we've lost 1 year only on that point,
wow.
Choosing the supplier. The second point, I think, is that I'm still struggling with my colleague in charge of finance to have the tax exemption. This is a real difficulty, but I'm still thinking that we'll succeed. And and the third point in the case of Côte d'Ivoire is that we are still struggling to have the price we think affordable for students, for example. They had in Senegal 50%, I've noted, 50% coming from universities. Maybe they have special resources for that, but we don't have in our plan in Côte d'Ivoire, we don't have this 50%. So we can have tax exemption, maybe the same amount, the same percentage, 26%. We can have some subsidy from the universal service, maybe 10 or 20%, but all the difference will be paid by the students. So 50 to 60%. That's still for the level of grant the students have in Côte d'Ivoire, that's still a high amount. So I think these are the three difficulties we're facing in Côte d'Ivoire.
Okay, excellent. So we have heard this morning also that mindset need to change. And also that is not only externally, but it's internally, it's ourselves, okay? So, and we have heard right now from both from Senegal and from Côte d'Ivoire that one of the key challenges has been convincing our own government on the taxes, on all the paper Can you, both of you, share? You have convinced, because you have deployed the program. What you would like to recommend your colleagues that are right now here listening to you? Because you already overcome that barrier. They maybe not yet. So what is the recommendation, or how you convince it, your prime minister, or how you convince it, your minister of economy, for that tax exemption? So, and I know that it's a very challenging question, and I know that Dato Sanil will be interested also to.
I was just going to say, the ones in the room don't need the convincing. They're here. They're in the right place. It's the people not in this room.
But I think it's good to listen from His Excellency Niani and Minister Kone. If you would like to share briefly, what do you think that made them got it?
Maybe I will start. The first is a point that is regularly raised by ITU, saying that in a country like Côte d'Ivoire, with an economy like Côte d'Ivoire, 10% of penetration of broadband generate 1 point of GDP growth each year. Every minister of finance can measure what that represents, and that can be a big amount.
So
10% generate 1 point of GDP growth.
So I think it is
the main argument we have. The second argument, I think, is not in figure, but is that ICTs improve all the economy. When you invest in ICT, you invest indirectly in each sector of the economy. When we invest in ICT in Côte d'Ivoire, we are sure that we are impacting agriculture, we are impacting exportation of cocoa, of banana, of coffee. We are impacting education, we are impacting health, every sector. And that can be also measured. And these two arguments for me are the maybe the first to give to the Prime Minister and the Minister in charge of finance.
Okay, so if I can summarize, I will say that he's talking his language. When you talk his language, he really got it, he really understand. So, His Excellency Niani, so if you can share how you convince it, your Prime Minister, or how you convince it, your Ministry of Economy, to have this tax exemption and supporting the program.
Merci, Président. Juste deux choses. Premièrement, on a dit au gouvernement qu'il y a 26% d'étudiants qui abandonnent parce que souvent ils n'ont pas de place dans les amphithéâtres.
Thank you. Well, I'd like to make two points. First of all, we said that there are 26% of students who drop out because they simply can't find room in the amphitheater.
Si ces étudiants ont maintenant des ordinateurs, ils ont des cours en ligne, ça leur permet de rester dans le système.
So if they have access to computers and to online classes, then they can remain within the system.
Donc c'est un investissement.
So it is an investment from that point of view already.
Deuxième chose, l'année dernière, le Sénégal a eu 33 000 bacheliers.
So last year, Senegal had 33,000 students obtaining the baccalauréat.
Les universités publiques ne pouvaient accueillir que 26 000.
And the public universities could only receive 26,000.
Il restait 6 000 étudiants.
So that leaves 6,000.
Les 6 000 étudiants, le gouvernement a payé les universités privées pour les accueillir.
And the government paid the private universities to take on these 6,000 students.
Wow. Donc, en disant que si on paye des 6 000 ordinateurs aux étudiants,
so if you buy 6,000 computers for the 6,000 students.
Ils sont dans les universités virtuelles où ils ont des cours en ligne.
And that they go to a virtual university where they can follow online classes.
C'est une économie pour le gouvernement.
This is actually a saving. This would be a saving for the government.
Et une économie sociale parce que ça évite des crises.
And it's also important from the point of view of social policy because it avoids social tensions and crisis.
Et ils sont tombés d'accord.
And so this was the argument that convinced the government.
Excellent.
Voilà le secret.
Excellent. So if I can summarize, I think it's every country is different, but it's a similar approach that the minister shared with us, and is at the end is talking his language. So it's a benefit for the Minister of Economy because they don't need to pay in another way. And it's a social benefit that at the end will come back to the government and to the society. So very good two examples. Thank you for sharing. So we have still time for one, two more questions from the audience. Please, a microphone. Identify yourself and try to be brief and concise in your question, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Sayav Nyumu. I come from France for eHealth company. Just we see that ministry are doing a lot of effort. Can the service provider like Orange also be involved? I mean, for example, when it's remaining 26% for the student, if they can give just a computer connected with the through their network for 1 year, so maybe they can give the computer to the student and say, you stay with us 1 or 2 years. Is this possible or not?
So the question is for the panel or is for Orange? So I can you be precise on what the question is for the panelists? So I'm sure the Orange person will be happy to talk with you after all, but if you have a question from the audience, so from the panelists, so can you repeat your question for the panelists? Or
my question, in fact, is for the panelists, is for the ministers, if they can deal with the telecom company so that because the telecom company is a private company, they need to know what they will earn, what will be their benefit if they do it. They have a lot of money. They can put a lot of money inside. And now we are looking for money that the student will pay, and he doesn't have it. The telecom company can give it to the student, but not in cash, but as a computer. For example, in Europe, we never buy our mobile phones. The telecom company, they give it to us every time. But we stay with them for 1 year. So the government can use the kind of system so that the student doesn't have anything to pay.
Okay, mm-hmm. Okay. So I think the question is direct for His Excellency, Minister.
Okay,
so.
Okay, I'll try to answer. In a previous life, I could have answered on behalf of Orange, but today I could not. I cannot. Okay, as a minister today, what I can say that is that in Côte d'Ivoire, we appreciate the collaboration with private sector. In Côte d'Ivoire, the private companies, especially mobile companies, have contributed a huge amount, thousands of computers and laptops have been given to the education system, the public education system. So that helps us equip today, I think, more than 200 secondary schools in Côte d'Ivoire. So I can say that that is appreciable. The second thing is that the private sector contributes indirectly because the persons who pay for the Universal Service Fund. Today, it is 3% of the turnover each year. In Côte d'Ivoire, it's close to 30 million US dollars each year. So it's quite appreciable. And we can use this money to invest or to give subsidies to make things. So I think we should not neglect this contribution of the private sector.
Excellent. Okay. Excellent. Hmm. So any more questions from the floor for the panelists? Please, a microphone here in first line. Please identify yourself.
Yes, good afternoon. My name is George Chai and I'm from the Asian Development Bank. I have a question for AT&T, actually. I was very interested to hear about your program for training and for financing this training. I was wondering, is this part of your corporate social responsibility program within AT&T, or is this part of your regular business? Because I'm wondering if this could be replicated. I mean, you said that you were active in several countries throughout the world. Mm-hmm. Is this part of your CSR program, or is this part of your regular business?
Thank you. So a little bit of both, right? So the money made available in the Aspire program is from our foundation. And so that's there. But we've also done a lot of things to pair the priorities that we've set through that program, so that as well, for example, things that employees are doing in the community or working with universities or schools near the places where we have locations of business, not just in the US but outside the US, has also been a very aligned part of what we're doing. So this emphasis on education has kind of filtered throughout. Definitely a funding element, but also an element to, for example, one of the locations where we have a good sized technical workforce in the eastern part of Slovakia, Kosice, the office there has done a lot of close work with the university. And our office in London has partnered with a secondary school to do mentoring and to bring job shadowing and to bring kids in so that they can see and experience some of the workforce experiences. So it's a variety of factors. But what I think has helped set a tone is that it has been a tone set from the top. That the alignment here, it is philanthropy, but it is also very much about the long-term health of our community and our company, and they all fit together. So that's made it a very natural fit.
Okay, thank you very much. So we have still 5-6 minutes more. So I would like to ask each of the panelists to share in 1-2 minutes, 1 minute if it's possible, a final recommendation for the audience. So you have gone through very tough moments implementing your projects and convincing your bosses. So what you would like to share as a final recommendation to your peers, colleagues in the floor? And just try to be concise, 1 minute, and then we will wrap up. Please. Okay, so we will start with Minister, His Excellency Minister Kone. Hmm.
Je vais revenir en français. Juste pour dire que il n'y a de richesse que d'hommes, et que l'intérêt de nos États, c'est d'investir le plus que nous pouvons dans les ressources humaines. Tout argent qui est mis dans la formation, qui est mis dans l'éducation, est un argent entièrement rentable. C'est un argent dont le retour sur investissement est assuré. Donc il ne faut avoir aucune hésitation à investir dans ces matières-là. Et la chance que nous avons aujourd'hui, c'est de disposer d'outils, les TIC. Maybe you should translate this.
So I'd just like to say that wealth is mankind itself. Investment in human resources is something that is, by definition, by its very nature, profitable, with a guaranteed return on investment. So I would say you should never hesitate to invest. And now we have the good fortune of having ICTs as a vehicle through which we can invest in human resources.
Et surtout pour nos États africains, nos États africains qui sont encore en voie de développement ou qui sont relativement pauvres, les opportunités que représentent les TIC doivent être complètement exploitées. Ce sont de vraies richesses, de vraies solutions pour nos États qui permettent à la fois l'efficacité, mais également une réduction importante de coûts. Tout à l'heure, M. Nian faisait allusion, par exemple, à la difficulté qu'il y avait à trouver des amphithéâtres et qui était résolue par les TIC. En Côte d'Ivoire, nous avons la difficulté d'avoir des enseignants qualifiés dans toutes les universités, puisque nous avons des universités sur toute l'étendue du territoire. Aujourd'hui, avec les TIC, d'un point, il est possible d'atteindre tous les autres. Donc, c'est de vraies opportunités dont des États comme les nôtres, qui n'ont pas beaucoup d'argent, devraient davantage profiter. Voilà, je conclue sur cela. Merci.
So I'd just like to say that for African countries in particular, developing countries, poor countries, ICTs represent a major opportunity that should be exploited to the full. They can provide a solution to our countries. They can increase efficiency. They can reduce costs. Mr. Nian talked just now about the difficulty of having adequate capacity in amphitheatres and how it was possible to solve that problem via the use of ICTs. Now, in Ivory Coast, we have a large number of qualified university teachers, and we can use their skills, spreading them through ICTs throughout the whole country. So these ICTs represent a major opportunity that we should seize.
Excellent.
Merci, M. le Président. En ce qui nous concerne, je pourrais conclure sur deux choses qui me semblent importantes. La première, c'est le constat. Le Sénégal, je disais tout à l'heure, a eu 33 000 nouveaux bacheliers en 2011, 41 000 bacheliers en 2013, et nous attendons 50 000 bacheliers l'année prochaine. L'accès des étudiants pour leur permettre d'avoir des ordinateurs et de rester dans le système est nécessaire.
Well, I'd like to make two points. First of all, as I said, that we had 33,000 high school students getting their baccalauréat in 2010, 41,000 in 2012, and it's been 50,000 next year. So it's important for them to have access to computers.
La deuxième chose, c'est l'enjeu du financement dans un pays à revenus moyens. La pérennité de ce programme nécessite un financement important et durable.
And second point is the challenge of financing. We are a middle-income country, and it's important, therefore, to have a sustainable system to fund this project.
Et nous comptons, l'État va mettre des ressources. Les partenaires de développement, mais également les sociétés de télécommunications et la structure de régulation des télécommunications au Sénégal. Et nous pensons qu'avec ce modèle économique, le projet pourra continuer à être pérennisé.
So the state will provide financing, but also the private sector, the regulatory bodies, and with the structure that I've described to you, I think that we now have a sustainable footing.
Je vous remercie.
Thank you very much. So, Eric, please.
The simple point, as we've been talking about many of the examples today, there is just a tremendous opportunity for collaboration between private sector and the public sector. The interests of a well-educated community are aligned, and so the best I can say is just for finding the many opportunities to cooperate. AT&T and Shreel and the MC have had some interesting opportunities, and there are a lot of other things out there. So I think that's an exciting potential for all of us.
Excellent. Sari, please.
Thank you, Eric. We certainly you know, there's, I don't know how many of you are students of English literature. There's a quote that I'd like to share. This is a 17th century poet. A little learning is a dangerous thing. Drink deep or taste not the Pyrian springs, for the shallow draughts intoxicate the brain, and drinking largely sobers us again. You know, in our journey in Malaysia, we've gone through hills and vales, trying this, trying that, spending some money here and there. Because in those days when we started the journey, because there was a dream. The dream was to transform Malaysia and become a developed country, to become a developed country by the year 2020, to have ICT as the driver and the next engine of growth. That was the policy set by the Prime Minister then, Tun Dr. Mahathir, and that was the driving light, if you like. There were no books to refer to, there was no programs to refer to, there was nobody to look at. So as we went along in that journey for the last 15 years, you know, many times when we've had to drink deep, because we were thinking, oh, we know this one, this is the solution. 2 years later, we were proven, no, that's not the way to do it. We are a little wiser. I think we now know enough to know what we do not know. It's useful to know what you do not know. For when you know that, then you know you're a little wiser. I think long and short, you know, we've been very fortunate that the industry in Malaysia has also been supportive to also share the same vision to develop the country. Including foreign investors like AT&T coming into Malaysia. So that ecosystem, you know, Intel is a big partner for Malaysia. That entire ecosystem, helped by friends and colleagues alike, has definitely helped us along our journey. Because only in 2006, our household broadband penetration was below 30%. Now in 2013, 6.5 years later, we've almost hit 70% household penetration on broadband. And we hope to grow further, and God willing, you know, we'll get there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So we have run out of time. So I would like to thank you very much, our distinguished panelists today, for sharing their projects. I think at least we have learned about very different ways of financing e-learning programs, from universal service funds, from subsidies from universities, from private sector, partnering with a public sector, with also banks, international banks, local banks. So I think the duty is in every of us to try to find a way to make it happen. The first question that we have at the beginning, how we make it happen. So just if Minister Kone allow me using his words, so tenacity and don't give it up. So if you have your dream, how to make that happen in your country, go for it and partner with public and private sector, and you will find a way to do it. So thank you very much. Mm-hmm.